Hi everyone, a very good evening to everyone. So just a second, let me check whether it is streaming or not. Okay, so my name is Bhanu Priya. Here in an academy, I'm dealing with the plus courses in the subtopic COA and the theory of computations. So here I'm in this YouTube live session today, I'm going to give a different means what are the main concepts that are present that you are going to learn in this COA subject. Okay, so that will help you in writing and solving the problems in the COA. Okay, so what are the main concepts that you have to be learned, that we will see in this session. So if you want to renew with the means join with the plus academy, Unacademy for the plus course, okay, so there you're having the live sessions will be there. So all live and structured courses will be provided in this Unacademy, and the lessons by all top educators are there. So unlimited lectures you can watch in this Unacademy channel, and there is a weekly quizzes and doubt clearing sessions are going to be provided in this channel. Okay, so every week, so whatever the concepts that you have learned in the so far the week, that will be based on that topics, weekly quizzes will be conducted, and for every four sessions a doubt clearing session will be there. So in the doubt clearing session you can solve your doubts also. So if you want to renew with the means join with the Unacademy plus course, you can use my referral code, that is a Bhanu P10. Okay, then you'll get the 10% discount. Okay, so now let's start the class. Okay, so now today's topic is what? It's a computer organization, and what are the main important concepts that you are going to learn in this computer organization? Let's have a look on this. The computer organization and architecture, there are totally five important topics are present in your this complete subject. Okay, in this complete subject, the five important topics are that you have to be learned. One is the cache organization, pipelining, IO data transfer, addressing modes, and number representation. So these are all the main concepts that where the questions are coming in the gate point of view. Okay, so actually the computer organization subject is completely dealing with the hardware as well as the software. It is a combination of the hardware and the software that you're going to learn in this subject. So that you are already known. So in this entire COA, try to learn the from the starts with the basic and try to solve more problems on cache organization, pipelining, IO data transfer, addressing modes, and number representation. Actually, your complete syllabus is divided into these parts. Still, there are subparts out there, but the main concepts in your complete syllabus is the machine instructions and addressing modes, ALU data paths and control unit, instruction pipelining, memory hierarchies. So there you are going to learn about the cache, main memory and secondary memory, and input-output interface, that is about the interrupts and DMA module. So your subject is deals with this, and the topics that you have to be keep more concentration on the CO subject is cache organization, pipelining, IO data transfer, addressing modes, and number representation. Okay, so now I want to give a clear an overview about all these topics and what are the problems that may come in these topics. Okay, so let's have a look. So the first thing is coming to the machine instruction. Okay, come to the machine instruction. You know, the machine instruction means everything is in the form of ones and zeros, so that everyone knows. The people who are learning about the CO means everyone knows that the machine instruction is in ones and zeros. The system can understand. What is a system? System means the CPU. The CPU can understand, okay, understand only the machine language. So that is also in the format of instruction format. So it will read the data, whatever the data. Suppose you are giving like add R1 comma R2. This is your program statement, one instruction in your program. So this program will be converted into instruction format. So that instruction format will be read by the CPU. The CPU consisting of ALU. Okay, so this is going to be read by ALU. So how the instruction format will be represented of this statement. This is my statement. This statement you can understand. Add R1 comma R2 means adding R1 plus R2 and the result will be stored in R1. That we know that. But how the system will know? How the system will be know? It will be in the represented in the form of instruction format. Then the system can understand. So the instruction format is divided into operand, operand, opcode, and the mode. Either you are getting indirectly or directly that address, or you are getting indirectly or directly, that will be explained by this. So operand means we are getting the values. Suppose add a comma b, so a and b are the operands that are present in the main memory. So the main memory is divided into instruction date, instruction code and the data. Okay, so these operands A comma B will be present on the data memory. So that will be, that address will be stored in operand. And coming to the opcode, opcode means operation has to be performed. That is an instruction like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, carry, jump, equal, everything. All types of instruction means the operation has to be performed. Doing some manipulation, that instruction address will, that instruction will be present in main memory. So that address will be placed in this opcode field. So this I mode is telling, or you getting the data directly or indirectly, means what type of addressing mode you are using, that will be decided by this I. So by seeing this instruction, the CPU can understand what instruction is it. By seeing address, address has one opcode in the look ahead buffer. Okay, so it is fixed, means for each and every system that address will be fixed for that particular system. Okay, so by seeing, suppose 011 is there, by seeing 011, the system ALU can understand it is addition opcode. Okay, means we have to perform addition operation. And operands means R1 and R2, those address will be stored here and that operation will be performed. This is actually the machine instruction. Okay, now coming to our topic. So once again, okay, so now coming to our topic, like I said, one of the important concept in gate point of view is of instruction format. So first you have to know about what exactly the instruction is. If you know the instruction, then you are able to explain about the instruction format. So that's why I have taken it as, so that's why I'm trying to explain about the instruction. I hope you guys all understand what exactly the instruction register contains. The CPU can read only the, ALU can read only the instruction register. So that will be divided into opcode, operand, operand, opcode and the mode. Okay, so in this format the CPU can understand. Now coming to the instruction format, the instruction format is of four types: zero instruction formats, one instruction format, two, three addressing instruction formats. Okay, and there are some different problems they will ask based on this instruction format in the gate point of view. Okay, so I want to give a small examples on these instruction format, means how these instructions will be represented, and then I'll take one problem to solve on instruction format. Okay, so first let me take about the three address instruction format. So how will be three address instruction format means three address fields will be there. Two address instruction format means two address will be there. One address means one address. Zero means there is no address instruction, address field will be there. Okay, so now three address instruction format consisting of like address of operand 1, Remember, students, we are talking about instruction format. Three address instruction, two address instruction, one address instruction means it's relating to only operand, not opcode. Opcode is anyhow it is present in the main memory, in the code memory register. We are getting that address. That is no problem. For opcode, there is no conflicts and we don't require anything. So here the instruction format, we are talking about the operands. Okay, operands. So let's see. I said the three address instruction format means operand. Let me take operand one address, operand two address, and operand three address. And here your opcode will be present. Here your opcode will be present. Suppose your opcode of size 8 bits. Let me take in the top form of bits, 8 bits. And operand 1 is 24 bits. Opcode 2 is 24 bits. And opcode 3 is 24 bits. Like that it is there. Okay. So total it is 8 bits means 1 byte. And this is 3 bytes. And this is 3 bytes. 3 bytes. So the total instruction size is 10 bytes. 3 plus 1. So total my instruction size is 10 bytes. In that way you are going to find out the size of your instruction. So this is a three address instruction. So I hope you understand what the three address instruction is. Clear? Now let me explain you the two address instruction. Okay. So let me explain the two address instruction format. The two address instruction format means how many address fields will be there? Only two address fields will be there. Two address fields. Okay. That means your instruction consisting of operand two address and operand one address. Okay. And your opcode. So anyhow, opcode is having a fixed, means the address will be getting from the main memory, and these two addresses will be present on the main memory in the data, in the data memory, you are getting the that addresses and you are placing here. Suppose if the example for this is add A comma B. So add A comma B means A plus B, the result will be stored in A. So this is the format of two addressing instruction. Suppose if your instruction is like this, add X comma A comma B. That means A plus B is added and the result will be stored in X. So this is a three address instruction format because we are using three operands. If you are using two operands means that is a two address instruction format. Okay. Now let's see about the one address instruction format. One address instruction format. So the one address instruction format consisting of add operand one address. That's it. Add is an opcode. Operation has to be performed. And operand one address is only one address instruction format means only one operand will be present. Okay. So then how you are going to perform the operation? So let us take example. Add B. How it is going to perform? There is no register. There is no another operand to if you want to perform addition means we require two operands, right? If we require two operands to perform the operation, but here only one operand is there. Add B. That means here this B will be added with the accumulator and the result will be stored in the accumulator. Accumulator is a temporary register which is present inside the CPU, means inside the here the ALU is there. Okay, ALU is performing the operation and the result will be first stored in the accumulator. It's a temporary register. Okay. Excuse me. Stored in the accumulator, temporary register. So whenever one address instruction format is given, the operand value, whatever your given operand value, that will be added with the accumulator. Already previous value, accumulator contains already previous value, that will be added with the accumulator, and again the result will be stored in accumulator. So this is a one address instruction format. And the last one is a zero address instruction format. Okay, if one address is there, then the second opcode is we are taking as an accumulator. Then what about this one address instruction format? Okay, what about this one address instruction format? Sorry, zero address instruction format. If nothing is there, what operation we are going to perform? If nothing is there, let me tell you. zero address instruction format. So this zero address instruction format means simply add is there. Simply add. So what it is doing, simply add means. So always the zero address instruction format will work on the stacks. So whenever we are written add means, okay. So whatever that is there in the top of the stack, that will be added to the next number and both the result will be again placed on the top of the stack. I'll explain with an example. See here. Suppose I'm taking push A, push B. Okay, push A. Let me take a simple example to explain this. I'm taking example as Y is equal to A into B minus D plus C divided by E. This is my instruction has to be executed by the CPU. The CPU has to execute this instruction. How it is going to be execution? Let me take a three address instruction format and I'll take the zero address instruction format. Let's see how it is going to be executed. Okay, you'll get the same result, but the instruction formats that you're using is the different. That is, means your instruction format is the different, but you'll get the same answer. See here. So first, what it is doing? The three address operand. I'm using three address instruction format means, see, I can use three operands. Mul y comma a comma b. That means y is equal to a into b and the result will be stored in y. Okay. So now I'm taking add d comma c. That means d plus c is added and the result will be stored in d. So this is over and this is over. Now coming to divide. Divide. So D contains the result D comma, sorry. So D comma E. That means D is equal to D plus C. Already it contains D plus C and divided by E. That result will again stored in D. Now finally. So this complete instruction is stored in D and this is stored in Y. Now I have to perform subtraction. Subtract Y comma D. So anyhow, you get the same answer. So in this way, it will the three address instruction format will be performed. And finally, these address subtract y, comma d address will be stored in an instruction format. So the address of the d, okay, address of the, one second. So the address of div d comma d. And subtract y comma d. Okay. So the instruction field consisting of the address of operand y, operand d, address of operand y, address of operand y, and opcode of the subtract. So these addresses will be stored in this instruction format. Then my CPU can understand to perform the operation. So this is a three address instruction format. Let me take the zero address instruction format. Zero address instruction format. So without operands, how it is going to be performed? Okay, let's have. So I'm taking the, whenever the zero address instruction format is there, we have to take the help of the stack. So with the help of the stack only, the zero address instruction format will be working. So first I have to push A. I'm just pushing push A on top of the stack. Next, push B on the top of the stack. Now what I am doing, I am just simply writing mul. Whenever I return mul, the top of the stack is multiplied. Okay, the top of the stack is multiplied. That is A into B now becomes the top of the stack. Top of the stack and the next element both will be multiplied and the result will be stored on top of the stack. So one is over. Now coming to the D. Push D. D is push. And then push C. After that, I have to, what operation I have to perform? Add. So whenever I have written add, this D and C both will be added and it will be stored on the top of the stack, D plus C. Now I have to perform push E. Push E has to be pushed on the top of the stack. Now what I have to do? Divide. Whenever I have written a divide instruction, the top of the stack element and the next instruction will get divided. So now it becomes the top of the stack contains D plus C divided E and A into B. Now, the final thing I had to do, subtract. Whenever I have written the subtract, the top of the element and the next element both will be subtracted. And my final string I will get is a into b minus d plus c divided e. You will get on the top of the stack. So, this is how the zero address instruction format will be working. Okay. So, I hope you understand what exactly these instruction formats are. Clear? So, now have a look on this. What are the problems that will be coming on this instruction format? Okay. So, just have a look on this. What are the problems that will be coming? A processor has a 16 instruction integer register. So, a processor is having a 16 integer registers R0, R1 up to R15. So, and 64 floating point registers. So, floating point registers are there as well as integer registers are also there. It uses a 2-byte instruction format. So, here our concept. A machine consisting of 2-byte instruction. A 2-byte instruction format my system is consisting of. That means 16 bits. 16 bits means the possible encodings here is 2 power 16. The possible encodings is 2 power 16. Okay, keep it aside. Now coming to, a processor has 16 integer registers. So let's have a note on that also. A processor have a 16-bit integer registers means, how much you get? 2 power 4 means 16. So number of possible, number of bits in the integers are, number of bits for one integer register is 4 bits. Now coming to the floating point. For the floating point, there is 64 floating point bits are there. 64 floating point bits are there. So the number of registers, number of bits for one floating point register is. So how you get 2 power 6 is nothing but 64. So total number of bits is 6 bits. So for floating point, the number of bits represented is. Total number of floating point bits is 6 bits and the integer bits is 4 bits and the complete machine instruction is 16 bits. So, these information I got up to now. So, what they are asking, there are 4 categories of instructions, type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4. 4 categories of instructions are there. So, type 1, what they are saying, type 1 consisting of 4 instructions. Type 1 consisting of 4 instructions. So, what are these 4 instructions? 1, 2, 3, 4 instructions are there. 4 instructions, 3 integer instructions are there. IR, IR and IR. Okay. And 1 opcode is there. So, anyhow opcode will be there. Right. This is clear. So, this total number of, now type 1, type 2. So, the type 2 instruction is, category consisting of 8 instructions are there. So, here these are the 4 instructions. Type 1 is of 4 instructions and this is of 8 instructions. Okay. The 8 instructions consisting of 2 floating point registers. 2 floating point registers. Floating point register 1. Floating point register 1. And anyhow it is opcode. Okay. Let me erase. Remember these students. 4 integer registers are 4 bits and floating points are 6 bits. And total my instruction size it's a 16 bit. Okay, now let's note on the type 3. So type 3 what they have said. So the type 3 instruction consisting of 14 instructions. So here I'm having the 14 instructions. Okay, each with one integer register and one floating point register will be there. So that means one floating point register, one integer register and your opcode. And type 4. Type 4 consisting of n instructions. So they don't know how many instructions are there. They don't know 14 instructions for type 3, 8 instructions for type 2, 4 instructions for type 1. Type 4, they don't know. They are asked to calculate the maximum value of n how much. But this instruction type 4 consisting of one floating point register. and opcode. Okay, so we know the size of the instruction register. The instruction register size is 4 bits and floating point register size is 6 bits. Okay, so 4, 4, 4. Okay, 4, 3 is a 12. Anyhow, we know that the complete instruction size is 16 bits. So, the opcode is of 4 bit. Opcode bit of 4 bit. Now, coming to the 2. Here, the floating point register is 6, 6. 6 plus 6, 12. Okay, my complete instruction register of size is 16 bits. We already calculated here. 16 bits is my complete instruction size. So, the remaining bits are 4. Okay, this is also clear. Now, coming to the type 3. The type 3 floating point register is 6. Integer register is 4. 4 plus 6, 10. My complete instruction size is 16. So, the remaining bits are 6. 6 is my opcode. And here, floating point is 6 and the remaining bits 10 is my opcode. So, now I got all the values of the type 1, type 2, type 3 register. Okay. So, now let me calculate. Okay, let me calculate. So, a machine has 2 byte of instructions. That is my machine is consisting of size of 16 bit instruction. So, that is 2 power 16 is equal to type 1 plus type 2 plus type 3 plus type 4. Okay, so type 1 means the 4 instructions into 2 power 4. How many are there? 2 power 4. 4 into 2 power 4. Okay, so 2 power 4, 2 power 4, 2 power 4. So, 4 into 2 power 4. I'm calculating the opcodes. Okay, into 2 power 4 into 2 power 4 plus my second instruction. 8 into 2 power 6, 2 power 6. 2 power 6 into 2 power 6 plus my third instruction. 14 into 14 into 2 power 6, 2 power 4. 2 power 6 into 2 power 4. Okay. And my last instruction, that is plus my last instruction is, I don't know the total number of instructions. N into 2 power 6. Okay. So, this is what I get. This is what I get. Okay. So, finally, I'll get 2 power 10 is equal to, if you do that, 2 power 8 plus 2 power 9 plus 14 into 2 power 4 plus n. So, finally the n you will get as 32. So, just calculate yourself. Just calculate by yourself, you will get this answer. So, here my concept I want to explain you. Learn the instruction formats. Okay, if you know the instruction formats and how the address bits will be converted, then you can able to solve the problem. So, this is one way of asking the questions. Okay, so I'll explain one more example on this instruction format. So here a processor has a 40 distinct instructions are there. Means 40 distinct instructions are there in my processor. Means the number of bits of opcode is instruction. Remember that, student. Instruction means opcode. Operation has to be performed. Okay, and the operand is the values is the operands. So whenever they said about instruction, means it is opcode address. The number of bits for opcode is, so it is around 40 distinct, right? So 2 power 6 means you will get 64 and 2 power 5 means you will get 32. So the 40 is present in between 2 power 6 and 2 power 5, means in between 6 and 5. So always take the largest number, 6. Number of bits per opcode is 6, that is clear. Next is 24 general purpose registers are there. Means number of bits of register, general purpose register, that is the operand values. Okay. Now calculate the number of bits of registers for one register. So here they are given 24. Okay. So 2 power 4 means 16. So the 24 is present in between 32 and 16. That is in between 5 and 4. So let's take the higher value 5. So number of bits per opcode is 6, I got, and number of bits per one register is I got 5. Okay, is it clear? Now, a 32-bit instruction word has an opcode, two register operands, and an immediate order. So what is my instruction format? Have a look. So this is the one immediate operand will be there, and two register operands, operand 2 and operand 1. Anyhow, your opcode is there. So what there is, actually the total number of bits occupied by two registers, the total number of bits occupied by two registers is and opcode. Okay, total number of registers occupied by two register, opcode value is 6 and two registers is 5 and 5. So total how much you get? The 16 you got. My total length is, what they are saying, my total length of my instruction size is 32-bit. This is 32-bit. So 6 plus 5 plus 5, I don't know about the immediate value, plus x is equal to 32. Then finally, x value is 16. This is 16. 16 plus 16, 32. That's a simple way of solving the questions. Okay. So that is about one of the important concept in COA about the instruction format. So try to learn about all the four different types of instruction formats and try to solve the problems on that instruction format. Now the next one is the addressing modes. The addressing modes is also one of the important concept in computer organization, the gate point of view. So you'll get a questions from this also. So you already know that addressing modes means I have to get the data from memory. How can I get? I means I am the CPU, or you can take ALU. I am the ALU who is performing the operation. So let's take the CPU. CPU contains ALU, registers, and the control unit. Everything will be present inside the CPU. Okay. I am the CPU. I want to get the data from memory, because the memory is itself is providing the data to me. Okay. So I have to get the data. How can I get? I can go directly and get the data, or I can go indirectly and get the data. So different ways of getting the data will be there. So you get a doubt, ma'am, why the CPU is not directly going and getting the data? Why these many of addressing modes we are using? Okay, here there are so many addressing modes are there. Implied, stack, immediate, direct, indirect, register indirect, relative, index, auto increment, auto decrement. So many addressing modes are there. So why we require these many of addressing modes? Why can't the CPU directly go to the memory and gets the data? Why using different techniques? Here, why we are using different techniques means the CPU is doing the multiple tasks at a time. Suppose if it is assigned, the data, if that it is not present here, suppose this memory location will be used by another, we are going to another memory location to fetch the data and to place the data. So sometimes it requires to go to another location and we need to get the data. Okay, and we are taking the help of different addressing modes. Okay, different ways we use the immediate addressing mode. Okay, if you want to get the data immediately, then it is already present immediately, means we can use that addressing mode. Direct addressing mode, indirect, sometimes the processor has to without wasting that means it can go to that particular address, and these addresses, another address will be there. I go into that address and getting the data from that address. So why all this doing these many of addressing modes means it wants to execute the work parallelly. Okay, so some memory locations are busy with some other data, and some memory locations are accessing full, or some are free, like that. So based on that availability, we are fetching the data and placing the data on the memory. So always dealings with the memory. These addressing modes are talking about the memory concept only. So from the memory, how you are going to get the data, and to the memory, how you are going to place the data. Who means here the CPU. CPU is going to place the data. So this is the way of different with addressing modes. So here I'm just giving a simple example on these addressing modes. By seeing this addressing instruction, which one will be the correct option? So this is the way, one way of asking the question in the addressing modes concept. So here I1 is equal to BJ. It's looking like that. One index is equal to, whenever these type of information is there, these type of information, this is nothing but the indexes. Okay. So where we use this concept, we are using these concepts in the form of arrays. If you are talking about the arrays, you have to mention index. So in which location, 0 index, 1 index, 2 index, in which location the data will be present. Okay. So by seeing simply this statement, you can identify that it is an index addressing mode. It is an index addressing mode. Okay. Now coming to the second statement. The second statement, while star A++, whenever you are seeing the plus plus in your programs, okay, in the for loop or while loop. So whenever you are seeing the plus plus, that means it is auto increment. It means auto increment. Now, int temp is equal to star x. Star x means it is pointer. It represents the pointer. Means in that particular address location, some address will be there. Again, you have to go to that address. There your exact data will be present. So that is the meaning of this star x. That is a pointer. It is representing the pointer. So pointer means indirect addressing. So by seeing this, what will be the option? Your C is the option. 1 points to B, 2 points to C, and 3 points to A. So, if you know the addressing modes concept, then you are able to solve this problem. Now, coming to the cache organization. So, cache organization means, you already know. Excuse me. So, you already know that cache is one type of memory. So, the hierarchy of memory, so you already know that is the registers, next is the cache. Next is the main memory, then is the secondary memory. So that concept we already know about the cache. Memory hierarchy. So register is the very fastest storage device and the capacity is very less. Next is the cache. Next is the main memory. Next is the secondary memory. So we are talking about the cache. Okay, here also you get a doubt. Why, ma'am, these many of memories are required? Is it not sufficient to take only one type of memory? Why here the CPU is there? If the CPU want to execute any instruction, any program, why we require these many of operation? Means in the CPU only you are having the registers and the cache. After that you are having the main memory and then you are having the secondary memory. So why we are using intermediately these many of memory devices? Why can't you use directly from secondary memory? Okay, because the CPU will take only the information in the form of a bits. So your program is a series of steps are there in your program. This complete program you cannot place on the CPU and you cannot place on the registers. Only the operation that has to be performed will be placed on the CPU. Now see your secondary memory consisting of folder. Suppose your movie folder is there. In the movie folder, the complete folder will be in the movies, a folder one movie will be there. Suppose ABC is a one movie. So that movie file will be placed on the main memory. So now my main memory consisting of ABC file. So now in that file, I want to see only one song in that file. So that song will be cut and placed on the cache. So now the cache is going to send that song to the register. Okay, only the what song that you want to be played, that at present this window I opened. So this information will be stored in the register. Now the CPU will execute that operation. So instead of reading the complete folder, it's just take whatever the operation that we required. So for that we required these many of memories. Okay, because it can't read all the data at a time and the CPU cannot hold all the information at a time. Whatever it want to be executed, that will be we have to be sent. So just like we are feeding to your a small baby. Okay, so for the small baby, how we are going to feed? Okay, we take the rice and we use to smash and after that we are just putting all the complete smashed rice, we are just making it as a juice and we are putting into child. So then only the child can able to digest. We can't put the complete food, like whatever we are eating, we can't keep the food to the child like that. Okay, so in between we have to do a lot of scrutinizing. Scrutiny has to be done and final thing will be sent to the CPU. So that is a the way the process will be there. So now coming to the cache organization. The cache organization, if you talk about the cache organization, the CPU, so this is my secondary memory. Secondary memory sends the data to the primary memory, means the files will be sent to the folder. In the folder, the files will be sent to here. The files will be converted into the blocks and that blocks will be sent to the CPU in the form of a bits or words, bytes. Again, that data, again, it can send to the cache memory. If the data is not present in the cache memory, then it sends to the primary memory. If it is not present in the cache memory, that you call it as a cache miss. Okay, that you call it as a cache miss. If the data is not, if the CPU want to execute some information, if that data is not present in the cache, then the CPU will go to the primary memory to get that data. That indicates a cache miss. In the cache, there is no data, whatever that I require. That I means the CPU required. So that will be sent to the, taken from the primary memory. Suppose if the data is present in the cache means, that is you call it as a cache hit. Okay, so now the thing here is how the problems will be asked in the cache. You get a doubt, ma'am, what are the problems that will be asked in the gate point of view? So in the gate point of view, they will ask about like hit ratios, all these things, CPU hit ratio, they will be asked. This is one way of one type of question they will ask. Hit ratio is equal to number of hits by total access, that is a hits plus miss. So I said hit means if the data is present in the cache, that is hit. If the data is not present in the cache, that is miss. And another way is the cache memory can be mapped by three ways: direct mapping, fully associative mapping and set associative mapping. These are the three techniques of mapping. So why we require these type of mapping? Okay, so main memory is there and here the cache memory is there. Now the cache main memory wants to put the data onto the cache. Main memory wants to put the data onto the cache. From the cache, the CPU is reading the data. Okay. Again, the CPU wants to put the data on the cache or it can go to the main memory. So, the main memory is divided into blocks. So, this is one block and this is another block and this is another block and this is another block. And the cache memory is divided into lines. Line 1, line 2, line 3. So again, this block consisting of words, word 0, word 1, word 2, word 3 and word 4. So each block consists of 4 words, let us take. And the cache memory consisting of L1, L2. So here the block size is equal to the cache size. So this is our concept. Generally our concept is like this. Now the thing here is, what are these three different mapping techniques? I'll give a clear description about this, means a small concept. Okay, so let's talk about the direct mapping. Direct mapping means, here my main memory is there. Okay, and here my cache memory is there. I want to place one particular word in the cache. So always the cache will occupy that space only. Whether if it is free or not. Suppose if it is not free, that data, whatever that is present, that will be erased and that will the word will be placed here. Okay, and whatever the, suppose this word will be, this word will always occupy the particular location. Okay, so that is a fixed one. Direct mapping, always that word 2 will occupy the first, second line and word 3 will occupy the third line. Like that, it will be the fixed one. Direct mapping. So for this, the CPU is generating an address. The CPUs generate the address of the main memory. Okay, so that in the main memory, it is generated the address. Okay, so that will be divided into block offset, line number, and tag. So this is about the direct mapping. Block offset, line number, and tag. Okay, remember this. This is a physical address generated by the CPU. Physical address generated by the CPU means the CPU saying in this address, let us take the 40 address. Okay, in this 40 address, these data will be there. Block offset means, so this is the block. Block 1, block 2, block 3, this is the block of the CPU. Oh, sorry, main memory is block. So in this block, the words are present. Word 0, word 1, word 2, word 3. Okay, so the block offset will be taken as 00, 01, 10, 11. Suppose if I want the second word in the first block, I'll write this address. 10 I will write here in the block offset. And coming to the line number. So now this block 2, word 2 has to be placed in cache. In where it has to be placed? In which line has to be placed? Okay, that is a line number. And the tag number is each cache consisting of tag identification. Where exactly it need to be placed. Okay, so this is about direct mapping. So next is fully associative. Fully associative means, here in the previously, whatever the block word that is present in the main memory, that has a fixed position in the cache memory. But in here in the fully associative, the main memory, whatever the word that it has to place in the cache, it can place anywhere. Anywhere it can be placed. One, it can place here, here, here. Anywhere it can place. That is a fully associative. So the tag, the physical for address will be like this. Block offset. Simply tag number. This is fully associative. And coming to the set associative. Set associative, the physical address will be like this. Block offset. Set number. And tag. Okay. So here set number, what is it? What it mean? So actually the drawbacks in the fully associative and the direct mapping, those will be overcome in the set associative. So direct mapping disadvantages means what? Whatever the field that is free, it is not using that field. So the locations are fixed in cache. So the block 2 in the main memory will be occupied the same place every time in the cache in that place only. So here you get a data will be overwriting and it will be data will be missed whatever the CPU wants. That is a disadvantage in the direct mapping. Then coming to the fully associative. So the fully associative means whatever the word that is there that can be occupy any line in the cache. Any line in the cache. Okay, then any line in the cache means wherever it is free, it is placing that data. Then what is the problem here? So CPU, if you want to find out the word 2 in the cache, it need to check each and every line. Every line it has to be checked. It taking lot of time. That is a disadvantage in fully associative. So these two disadvantages are overcome the set associative. That means here the cache will be divided into sets. Each set is again divided into blocks. Suppose the main memory wants to place the word 3 in the cache means, suppose if it wants to place in the set 1 means, it can place here or here. Suppose if this block is not free means, it can place in the same set in another block. Suppose a word 4 has to be placed in the cache means, it can place here or here. So here, wherever the space is there in the blocks, it can occupy that space. And again, the finding out of the element by the CPU is also very easy. Because of the set number, we can easily find out. Okay. So remember these steps only. Okay. So the formats, that is the direct addressing format, direct mapping format and fully associative format and set associative. So here is one example they are given. A block set associative cache memory consisting of 128 blocks. That means number of blocks in cache, what they are asking. Number of blocks in cache memory is 128 they are given. So it is divided into four block sets. Okay. So that means each set divided into four blocks. Okay. So number of blocks in one set is they are given four. The complete cache memory size is 128 blocks. So total 128 blocks are there. Number of blocks in set is 4. Okay. Now main memory size is also given. Main memory size is 16,384 blocks. That is my main memory size is 16,000 to 16383 blocks are there. That is the size of the main memory. Okay. Next, block size they are given. Each block size consisting of 8 bits. That means 1 byte is there. Sorry, each block size they are given as 256. 256 bytes. Each block. So this is 256 and this is 256 and this is 256. Each block size they are given as 256. In the blocks, you are having the word. You are having the word. So, one word is equal to, they are given as 8 bits. That is 1 byte. That means 256 words are present in each block. In each block, 256 words are present. So, this is the information they are given. Now, try to solve the problem. What they are asking? How many bits? So, this is a set associative. Remember that. Set associative means your physical address is in the form of block offset, set number and the tag field. So your physical address is in the format of this. Now they are asking how many bits are required for addressing the main memory. I want the main memory, how many bits are there? This complete physical address, how many bits are there? So for that, I need to be calculate the memory size. The memory size they are given as 16,384 blocks they are given. Okay, so converted into bytes. 16,384 into each block contains how many bytes? 256 bytes. If you calculate, 2 power 22 bytes are there. My physical address, number of bits required to address my main memory is 22 bytes. So this complete size, it is 22 bits. So I got 22 bits. Okay, so now let's see, it's a 22 bits over there. Now what they're asking, so I got the physical address of size 22 bits, total it's 22 bits. Now I need to find out the block offset I need to be find and the set number has to be found and the tag. So if I find two and anyhow the third one I'll get because our total length is 22 bits is, I know that. So now calculate the number of bits in block offset. Let me calculate the first one, number of bits in block offset. So that is block size is, how much is the block size? The block size is, they are given as 256 bytes. 256 bytes are my block size. That means how much? 2 power 8 bytes. So number of bits here is, the block offset contains 8 bits. Now calculate the set number. How you are going to calculate the set number? The set number in the cache is represents the number of lines in cache. The total number of lines in cache. Lines or blocks, anything, both are the same. Lines and blocks, both are the same. And the set size. So number of lines in the cache is 128 blocks are given. And set size is 4. Okay, it is divided into 4 blocks. Okay, each set consisting of 4 blocks. So you will get 32 sets. That means 2 power 5 sets. So you got the number of bits in the set number. So anyhow 5 plus 8 is plus tag is equal to 22. That means how much the tag? The tag consisting of 9 bits. So you got the tag value, set value, word value. So this is a way they ask the questions. Next concept is the pipelining. So in the yesterday's session, I explained about the pipelining also. The pipelining consisting of different stages. The stages may be up to K stages will be present. So based on your process, the stages may be varying. So if you take the risk processor, if your processor is of risk type, it takes the 5 stages. The 5 stages like fetch, decode, execute, memory access, and write back the result. So like that, the stages may be varying. So I explained about the pipelining concepts, like a pipelining. In here, the main concept here is you have to know the formulas. The formulas are very important to solve the pipelining problems. So the pipelining for execution time for pipelining. Execution time for the pipelining process is K plus N minus 1 into TP. So what is a K? K is nothing but the number of stages that are present in your pipelining. The fetch, decode, execute, the number of stages. N is nothing but the number of instructions in your program. Number of instructions in your program is N. And TP is the total cycle time. The cycle time. So if you know this, then you just substitute that value, you will get the execution time for the pipelining. Then execution time for non-pipelining. The formula for execution time for the non-pipelining is K into N into TP. Because after completion of one instruction only, the second instruction will be started in the case of non-pipelining. So that's why the total number of stages are K into total number of instructions into TP. This is the execution time for non-pipelining. Then the speed up of your processor formula is execution time for non-pipelining by execution time for pipelining. So remember this formula, students. Okay. So this is about all the main concepts in here. And one more concept is I/O interface. That is a programmed I/O, interrupt-driven I/O, and DMA controller. So try to learn all these concepts, because these concepts are very important while in the gate point of view. So try to be confident in the cache organization and in the pipelining and addressing modes and the last machine instructions, okay, and the numerical number representation. So these are most important concepts in the COA. So try to learn, put a lot of concentration on these topics and try to solve as many problems as you can, okay. So my request is to first learn the basic concepts and after that try to solve the problems. So if you like my sessions, means if you want to attend my sessions in an academy, so there is a plus course will be there. So there I'm teaching the COA as well as the theory of computation subjects. Okay, so this is an academy where all live and structured courses will be provided by this Unacademy. The lessons by all top educators will be are provided here. So you are having unlimited content you can get on your subject, and weekly quizzes and doubt clearing sessions will be there. So for every week you are going to attend a weekly quizzes. Whatever the so far topics that you learn on that particular week, at the end of the week we are conducting the weekly quizzes, and for every 3 sessions a doubt clearing session will be there. Suppose if you are having any doubts in that the so far covered 3 sessions, in the 4th session you can clarify your doubts in the doubt clearing session. Okay, so if you want to subscribe an academy, so you use my referral code BhanuP10, then you'll get a 10% of instant discount. Okay, so I hope you guys understand the topics, and all the best for your gate exams. Please prepare well and try to score a good rank. All the best. Bye.